Hey everyone, welcome back to some new malicious compliance stories, where people comply to the letter, but not the spirit of our request. I hope you had a great day. The first story is called Pay Double for It. Several years ago, I was employed by a government agency. I'm a professional, and I have mandatory continuing education requirements to keep my license. The agency, reluctantly, was paying the bare minimum for my annual license renewal and would pay for the cheapest annual training. A subgroup of the licensing entity exists for professionals who work in the same niche as me. At the time, the dues for the subgroup were $15 annually. The subgroup offered a package of all the required training, 1 hour each of two mandatory subject areas, and a total of 12 and a half hours. Most commercial training is around $150 to $200 per hour. There are some freebies here and there used by these companies as advertising, but they are not usually very relevant to my job. The very relevant subgroup training was $50 to members, so membership and training could be paid in one check for $65. A bargain. The agency bean counter said they could not pay the $15. So for a number of years, I refused to join the group, and the bean counter paid $100 for my training. After a number of years, I transferred to a different agency. The new bean counter had no issue with paying the membership to save money. The next story is called No Reek Off. A decade ago, my primary school had a lollipop man to help the kids cross this road. He was nearly 80 and had come out of retirement many years earlier to help out, since nobody else wanted to do the job. He and his pensioner friends would go for an annual holiday together, and it was the same time each year, so he could give the council plenty of notice. The council outright told him no, because it's in the middle of term time, refused to compromise and let anyone else cover for a week, and said if he goes ahead, then he shouldn't even think about returning to work when he gets back. He overestimated how much he wanted that job. He went on his holiday, didn't come back to work, and that means that instead of being without a lollipop man for a week, they've been without ever since. The third story is called Union President. I have worked in public education at a site for over 25 years. This supervisor was a new one, with a questionable past. I was newly elected union president. This supervisor did not like me, and I think felt threatened by my mere existence and went after me. From the beginning of the educational term, my supervisor and I clashed. They seemed to go out of their way to find something to talk with me about, write me up for, or simply question me about. At first, I chalked it up as trying to figure out what I did and how things ran, but it became obvious that it was going after me and wanting to get me fired. As a long-term employee in a public education system with a strong union, I am fairly protected. Add to that I am the union president of that strong union. That is not to say I could not lose my job, it just needed to be something bad. After multiple petty meetings, conference summaries, and write-ups, I got tired of it. I started to push back and I would not talk, even in public spaces, to the supervisor. They were invisible to me. I did not hear them. I did not talk with them. In fact, I would ask someone to give them a message while I was standing in front of them. Needless to say, this made them frustrated. If they wanted to talk with me, there was always another person from the union in the room with me. On one occasion, my reply was, I will not answer that question without my attorney present. And no, it was not an investigation of criminal nature. The supervisor kept rephrasing the questions, hoping I would slip up or answer. But no, I am not dumb enough for that. I answered the questions that did not answer his intended path, but would not answer the questions he wanted to nail me for. This made him so frustrated that he started to threaten my job and reassign me. He had to learn that he could not do that. He sent me a directive that I was to check in with his assistant each morning, check out for my lunch, and then back in, and then check out each day. If the assistant was not present, I was directed to text both him and the assistant if I was away from my desk. I was also instructed to only work my duty time, and I could not work outside my day. Okay, not a problem. Each morning I would walk past his office and check in. Every time I had to go to the copier, I would text them both. Every time I used the restroom, I would text them both. Every time I had to talk with someone away from my desk, I texted them. This got fun quickly. If I got called into a meeting by the dean or other higher administration, I told them I was not allowed away from my desk, office or classroom without the supervisor's permission, and that they needed to call him to get that permission. Needless to say, I was following the directive to the letter and blowing up things with a smile. This lasted about 2 weeks, before the dean and others started to get annoyed by the actions and directives of the supervisor. The increased pressure upon him became increased pressure on me. He was not getting the message and digging his heels in, because he's the boss and I was just a subordinate. When I was fed up, I brought in the regional union representative, and they started to get very clear with not only him, but the president of the educational institution, that the next meeting would involve the union attorneys, and we would be filing legal action under the state and federal laws. This would mean big dollars in attorney fees to even start to answer the complaint. And it costs us nothing for our attorneys and filing. My life got much easier. He was not allowed to talk with me, and he was placed on administrative leave for the remainder of the year, and never returned to educational employment in the area. And for me, life is great, and I am happy to work more hours than I am paid for. The last story is called Figure It Out. I used to work as a merchandiser for a national soda company about 10 years ago. One of the biggest problems we had would occur every holiday, when stores had serious sales on soda, like getting 4 12 packs for 10 bucks. The problem is that there simply isn't enough room in the back room to store enough product on a really busy holiday, like the 4th of July. Our sales reps brought order way more stuff than we ever had room for, and then it was up to me on how to Tetris it all into the space for us in the back. The way it should be done is to send multiple orders on days like that, as space becomes available. But of course, that means sending drivers to stores multiple times, which costs time and gas. I had one store that had a really strict backroom manager, with a no exceptions policy of pallets never being stacked more than 3 high. On this particular 4th of July, we literally had twice as much product than what would fit. So I called my boss and told him he needed to send a driver to buy back some of the excess load. He tells me to stack the pallets as high as the forklift will allow me to solve the problem. I remind him at this location I am only allowed to stack 3 high. He tells me to figure it out. I know that the backroom manager will get lava level mad when he sees this, but it's the boss's orders. So I'm up to 5 high when the manager sees it and goes crazy on me. I shrug and tell him it's my boss's orders. I finish stacking, with one tower now being 5 high, then start walking out as my shift is now done. The backroom manager tells me if I leave it like that, we can kiss our account with the store goodbye. I shrug and leave. I got a call from my boss 30 minutes later that there's a driver on the way to do buyback, and I need to go back to the store now. I tell him my shift is done for the day, and I have already returned the company truck, and I'm on my way to see some fireworks. It's 8 PM at this point. He tells me to turn around and go get it sorted. I tell him the only way I'm going back is if I get double time for the entire day, about 14 hours at that point, plus a 10% raise. He yells at me that it's never going to happen. So I tell him that me returning to the store is never going to happen. I also tell him that if he changes his mind, he can send an email to me, agreeing in writing to my terms. I had other side gigs at the time and wasn't concerned at all about this job. I got an email 30 minutes later from my boss's boss, agreeing to those terms. It is immediately followed by a phone call from him apologizing, telling me that I am needed and that I need to go back to the store as soon as possible. My boss's boss also sent my boss, who was already at home, to help sort the mess out. Hearing him apologize to the backroom manager was gold. Thanks for watching the video. I hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please don't forget to leave a like, comment and subscribe. And if you have time, watch another one of my videos. And now, I hope you have a great day. See you soon. Bye bye.